Listening Library presents Black Internet Effect. This is the author, Shavone Charles. I dedicate this book to the next generation of minds who will shape our world for the better. Prologue. I was 16 years old when I stood in the living room with my dad at my house in Southeast San Diego and watched a TV special that would change my life forever. It was a hot Saturday morning in 2007, and I rushed through the house, toothbrush in one hand, flute case in the other, scrambling to get dressed for a scorching day of marching band practice at Helix Charter High School. I was flute section leader in band and had to show up an hour early, so I was in a crazy hurry when my dad called me into the living room. "Hey, Shavone, where you at? Come on in here. You need to see this." I scurried over. "Look at this. Look at these people. Can you believe they're at work?" my dad touted. I looked at the TV to see clips of 20 to 30-something-year-old adults napping in lime green pods, eating ice cream sundaes, and riding down bright red 40-foot slides. For the first few seconds, it looked like I was watching a scene from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, one of my all-time favorite movies. I stood there with my mouth open, in awe of this pictured utopia. A few seconds later, Google's colorful, bright logo flashed on the screen, and my dad said, "Have you ever seen this? They work for Google. You should look up working for a place like that one day." I was bewildered by the thought. Me? Work for a search engine website? Up until that point, I hadn't thought once about a career path in the technology industry. I was enrolled in every AP class I could get into in high school because I knew I wanted to go to a university and be a writer. That was it. I had dreams of working on music and poetry. I even flirted with the idea of going to law school or being a college professor one day. Working in tech hadn't ever really crossed my mind until that day in the living room. Band practice would have to wait. I felt so drawn to the idea of this food heaven full of genius people who could nap throughout the day and wear Nikes and jeans to work. My eyes scoured the TV screen in search of a person of color, a Black person, anyone that could give me a sense of familiarity and otherwise convince me that this utopia was a welcoming real-life possibility for someone who looked like me. Even then, it was hard for me to fathom the idea of seeing a Black woman, a person like me, working at a place like Google. 30 minutes passed, the episode ended, and that bright feeling of hope and curiosity was quickly followed by an overwhelming sense of anxiety as I sat in the living room with no blueprint or knowledge of how to pursue a career that would ever lead me to a company like Google. Around that time, my high school counselors were laser-focused on college and more traditional careers. Technology wasn't often brought up as a possible professional path for me or any other Black students. At the time, the popular social media site MySpace was killing the game, and that was the main social platform of choice for me and my friends. We didn't view technology as a standalone concept or industry. It was simply interwoven into our everyday lives as the main way to forge community and stay connected to one another. The only reason I was ever introduced to HTML coding in the first place was because I wanted to customize the color and template of my MySpace profile. I also grew up in a household with parents who were Black small business owners and always preached about the importance of me going to college to get a good job. Every day, I watched my mother and father wake up to work from sunrise to sundown, and they answered to no one. They ran their own mom-and-pop businesses, our family restaurant, and a hair salon. They didn't have a 401k or a cushy corporate benefits plan, and always urged me to go to a university so I could one day get a high-paying job and avoid having to work as hard as they do. To all of us, that meant being a lawyer, a corporate CEO, or a doctor of some kind. I remember feeling so much anxiety, pressure, and fear whenever I thought about choosing the right career path after high school. I didn't envision myself in a pantsuit, working in an office cubicle anywhere. If there was an industry for me, I thought it would have to be in media, music, or fashion, where I could really express myself. Fast forward, and here I am, neck deep as a young Black millennial in Silicon Valley, navigating the world of tech and social media. Currently, I am at TikTok, where I was hired in a newly created role as the company's first ever head of diversity and inclusion communications. I officially started my career in the technology industry at 21 years old with my first full-time job at Twitter, where I led the company's global music and culture communications out of their San Francisco headquarters as the youngest and first ever Black woman to be hired onto their public relations team. After Twitter, I worked at Instagram, where I launched their Los Angeles office and managed all of the app's global music, teen, and youth culture communications. Again, as the youngest and first ever Black woman to be hired onto their marketing and communications team. At both Twitter and Instagram, I personally carved out my professional roles, and since then, I strive to bring my advocacy for voices of color into every room I'm in. I am the founder of my very own creative group, Future of Creatives, and I started Magic in Her Melanin, a community organization created with the mission to elevate the stories of women of color and drive equitable career development for next-generation creatives and people of color across the tech industry. I am a multi-hyphenate creative, classically trained musician, and activist who happened to find her way into the wonky world of the tech industry. My path has led me in many directions and down so many winding roads, all with the hope that in the spaces in which I am the first, I won't be the last. The right balance of curiosity and nerve have always pushed me toward good directions in my life. During the darkest, most discouraging times, I can lean on those two parts of myself. I credit the majority of my resilient, self-starter demeanor to my two parents, Bonnie and Daryl. I often think about that wide-eyed teenager who dreamed of just being able to be and unapologetically exist as a Black girl in every space she occupied. From childhood through early adulthood, I struggled to be accepted and welcomed anywhere, all because of what I looked like and what I represented as the only Black girl in the room. So where there wasn't space for me, I had to create it. Where I wasn't welcomed, I had to invite myself. When the room wanted me to stay small and invisible, I had to make myself seen. Against all odds, I had to value myself enough to know that my voice and perspective mattered. I've carried these survival tactics throughout my life, and it's all thanks to the superhero Black women who raised me. Through them, I figured out that I'd have to forge my own path and dare to write my own story, even if I was left out of the fairy tales altogether. Black Internet Effect. Truth be told, I applied to Google's BOLD, Building Opportunities in Leadership and Development, internship program on a pipe dream. I mean, who the hell was I kidding? I was a sophomore at the University of California, Merced. And that semester, I was living in Washington, D.C. as part of a highly competitive campus-wide academic program that allowed students to continue their college coursework remotely and gain on-the-job experience. I'd landed an internship with a San Diego congressman on Capitol Hill, where I was a professional letter reader. I had strict orders to fix the printer often, and I wrote up responses to San Diegan constituents from time to time. Jokes aside, I learned a lot during my time on the Hill, interning in Washington, D.C. I was an English literature major with a double minor in writing and sociology, and had a real passion for civic engagement and public service. This was also my chance to get an unfiltered look at the dicey and difficult world of politics and U.S. government. I spent an unthinkable number of hours interning for free on the Hill while completing a full load of coursework. One night, exhausted from a day of work, I sat in my dorm room and did some Googling on the top internships in the world, searching the best companies to intern for. as much respect as I had for all the incredible, passionate people I had met in DC, one thing was for certain. The majority of them were underpaid and emotionally run down by the demands of politics. Not only that, I also found that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.